Welcome, friends, to another edition of TiffinCast. I'm your host, Sei Shu, and today I'm speaking with Corwin Hiebert from Vancouver, British Columbia. And
right.
Corwin is a business manager for creative entrepreneurs, and he's written a book called Living the Dream. I would show it to you, but I don't think you can see it, but I'll link to it. And now he's got a new product, a new resource, actually, I should call it, called Business Action Planner. And I brought him in to talk a little bit more about what he is all up to and what this Business Action Planner really will do for photographers. So, Corwin, welcome to the show.
Excellent. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Hey, listen, I know I already talked a little bit about Living the Dream, which is your book that came out in 2013. It's putting your creativity to work and getting paid is the title of the book. Tell us a little bit more about your background. Like, how did you get involved with photographers in the first place?
Yeah, I kind of stumbled into it. You know, I think a lot of people, when they look back at their vocational careers, they look at some of the decisions they made and they realize that, how did I get there from here?
Right.
But I've always had a bent towards marketing and to management, and specifically project management. And as I started to apply some of those, you know, more sort of clear-cut business experiences and my skill set, I realized that it was really the creative people I was working with that actually was the part of the job that I really loved. And at that time, that was a few years ago now, some of my friends were starting to venture out and trying to put their creativity on the line, and one of those friends was David Duschman, and he started to, you know, photograph full time, and he went away on a trip. He knew he was going off the grid, and he said, "Corwin, I'm going to be away for like 3-4 weeks. Is there any chance you could like watch my inbox for me? You know, like just, you know, for my clients that need, you know, they're panicking, we do just watch my inbox." So he came back from his trip. And I'm like, "Yeah, I'm not giving your inbox back. I can take care of this better than you can."
Oh, wow.
You know, and he's like, "Hey, no problem." I said, "You know what? Just go photograph. I'll take care of your inbox. You go make pictures." And then, you know, then tax season came up and I said, "You know what? I'll take care of your taxes. I'll work with the accountant. I'll take care of that." You know, he even got GST audit. I'm like, "David, I'll take care of the tax audit. Don't worry about it." I'll, you know, and so as our friendship grew and as his business grew, you know, my sort of, you know, helpfulness turned into a business model. And so from, you know, from early on, it's been now, he and I have worked together for 6 years. So it's been sort of a transition of just, you know, being helpful, finding ways to meet those needs. And, you know, now his company, I run for him in a lot of ways. And I do the same for a lot of other creative people, mostly photographers. So it's, I've really, really sort of stumbled into it. But it's really rewarding work. And we love what we do.
Excellent. Having worked with photographers and having worked with other creative people, is there something in common that we photographers seem to stumble over all the time?
Yes. Photographers have a very, what photographers have in common with non-photographers, but the commonality being that they're freelance or they're sort of trying to put their creativity into the marketplace, is that there's this sense that, you know, kind of, you know, photographers think of it as have camera, will shoot. And that, you know, just by telling people I'm a photographer, that people will come to me. Other freelancers look at it a little differently, but basically it's just, you know, well, I'm creative. Don't people want creativity? Don't they want to come, you know, find me? And it's maybe just like how people can be a bit of a martyr for their own art. People can be a martyr for their own freelance business, and they just kind of assume that the marketplace will somehow well up and come find them. And so I think one of the biggest challenges, and it's common across photography all the way to other industries like graphic design, is that when there's no curiosity being, you know, sparked, mm-hmm. then there's no such thing as marketing. You know, a lot of photographers are looking for the right marketing, you know, solutions, the right tactics. You know, what should I be doing on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram? Or I really got to start blogging, or what, all they come up with all these ideas. I'm going to do postcards. I'm going to mail them to people. All those things are tactics or tools. The reality is that unless a freelancer is making people curious, no one will come knocking. And the challenge of standing out in the crowd is it's the wrong way to look at it. My perspective is draw a crowd. So if even if it's small, that small crowd is more valuable to you than, you know, you trying to clamor above the din or the noise mm-hmm. that everyone else is making. You know, Facebook is a great example of it where it's just very noisy. You know, it's visually noisy. And so a lot of photographers who are just getting started, they, you know, they're sharing photos, they're trying to get people to like them, and they look at their likes and comments on Facebook as an indicator of, you know, their ability to market themselves. And really, it's a total, it's a bubble. Mm. It's a bubble that, you know, doesn't produce, doesn't make people curious. It just, you know, it's sort of this knee-jerk, very light social reaction. So anyway, now I'm ranting. But.
No. Continue on, because I'm taking notes back here. So if the challenge for photographers is marketing, is that if the challenge is for photographers finding their clients, so your company then I guess caters to that and helps photographers find clients, is that a good assumption to make?
Yeah, in part. I mean, we're a management company. Mm-hmm. So it means that primarily our job is to handle the demands of their business. So we won't solicit on behalf of our clients. Like, I don't pick up the phone and, you know, hi, I'm Corwin. I work with David Duschman. He would really like to work with you. Right. That's my southern accent. What do you think?
It's terrible.
That was pretty bad, yeah. Sort of, hillbilly would be better. So, you know, we pretty much help our clients, you know, manage and handle the demand that's coming to them. And so typically those that can afford management services, they've already, you know, they've kind of been through the freelancer run a little bit. They've sort of, they've had some experiences. They've kind of had their hard knocks, or they're, you know, they're at that point where they can no longer do it just themselves. They need help with their business. And it doesn't make financial sense or business sense just to hire, you know, yet another assistant or yet, you know, someone to delegate to. And that's yes, we can be delegated to, but we help our clients really move forward, and we take over or take control of the things that, you know, we're really good at. So, and just to give you an example is, you know, guys like David Duschman, I mean, he's an educator as much as he is a photographer. So we help him create and publish, you know, a lot of the things that he does on Craft and Vision. Mm-hmm. That's part of our job. You know, he has his entry points where he, of course, is leading the charge with Craft and Vision, but then he relies on me and my team to, you know, pull that stuff off and make that machine work. So sometimes we're the cogs in the machine.
Indeed. What does success look like to you? If a client of yours, a photographer, succeeds, does that translate to your success as well, or do you feel like it has to be something else in the process of working with him or her?
That's an interesting question. I'm actually going to confess that sounds a little bit more loaded than you might have realized, but let me elaborate.
Yeah, please do.
So first of all, I think success for a photographer really, I think the conversation is changing in that I think photographers need to focus on being professional, regardless of the level of income they generate. Professionalism, I think, is that's the marker of someone that's killing it, that's doing exactly what they want to do, and they're doing it the best way possible. The challenge is that a lot of photographers, especially when they get started, they're like, well, I need to replace or and more my day job income. And though that is that's a great goal to have, the truth is that you're, as an artist in the marketplace, you're establishing a legacy. And that legacy is created by being an amazing service provider and by being someone that can just conduct themselves professionally. A lot of freelancers sort of, they think that because they're doing it maybe in the margins of their life, that they don't want to take it seriously, or they don't feel they need to take it seriously, whether it's, you know, whether it's communications, whether it's the sales process, whether it's their accounting, whether it's their documentation, whether it's that crazy shoebox of receipts in the corner, you know, whether it's, you know, how they treat their clients. It just, there's a lot of aspects of how they run a meeting. Mm-hmm. If they run a meeting, usually freelance photographers are a little like, oh, sorry, I'm late. I couldn't find parking. You know, they're a little frazzled, and they play the creative card. Whereas I think the professional says, you know what, I'm here early, I've got notes, I know exactly what we're going to talk about, here's the follow-up items, here's what I'm going to do. You know, just, I'm giving a small example there, but just being as professional as possible. So I think that's what success should look like for freelancers. How that translates to me? Well, the short answer is, and the one I get a lot when I tell people what I do, is they say, well, you know, how do I make money? And, you know, candidly, I'm a businessman. So I'm thinking, well, success for me, yes, of course, I want to add to my legacy, but I also want to pay bills and pay my staff and, you know, do the things that I want to do outside of work and not always stare at a laptop. And so a lot of people in the industry that that serve photographers, more commonly, they would be considered agents. People that go and solicit work, go find work, or they have the relationships in order to, you know, get those opportunities, and then they take a percentage and hand things off. I don't work on percentage. We're a professional services company, so we bill by the hour. Once we've established a relationship with a client, then we serve their needs within their, you know, budgetary limits or within the limits of their projects or whatever they're working on. So I'm involved with projects, you know, over the course of the year or years down the road. It's not just a one-shot wonder with us. We're here for the long haul. We're hard to get rid of, actually. But it's a lot of fun. So
good.
It's
Yeah. Let me ask you that question another way, perhaps. What thrills you about the work that you do? What thrills you about the work that you do?
Thrill?
Yeah.
What excites me?
Exactly.
Yeah. You know, when I see a creative person go really deep in the creative process, and that when they come out of it, because most creative people are able to do that. Most creative people at some point, there's whether it's a client project or their own, there's just some endeavor where they just know that they can, you know, go really deep in that creative experience. And when they come out of it and they realize that they're not swamped with everything else that they had to put on the back burner, that when they come out of it, they can take the time and energy to... Because you know what it's like, a really great creative experience, whether it's, you know, creating a great portfolio or body of work or a certain series or maybe it's, you know, you're doing a big print run and it's really, you know, you're whatever. You kind of come out of that and you realize, okay, I've ignored everything else and everyone else for months or weeks or however long. And the thrill for me is to be able to cover those things off so that when they pop their head out and kind of go, okay, I kind of need to like move on, they can do that with a lot more freedom. So I really enjoyed that experience.
Wonderful. Let's go back to talking a little bit about living the dream, because you've moved from, you know, writing a book to creating a set of tools for photographers, for creative people, called Business Action Planner, right? And that's just right. It's just come out. Tell me a little bit about how the book came about and why you now have something called the Business Action Planner in the for photographers. What is it? How do they connect?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So, Living the Dream, which came out with Peach Pit in 2013, that Living the Dream is like a snapshot of business for the creative person. My goal with Living the Dream was to kind of take the chaos and mystery out of a business, you know, out of the idea of a business, and appealing to that creative person and saying, hey, if you're thinking about, you know, a marketing effort, you know, maybe think about it in, you know, this way versus, you know, a more traditional way, or establishing a little bit more of a, you know, kind of appealing to the creative sensibilities of an artist, but saying, hey, here's some business principles, I think, and ideas that I think are really helpful for you. So that was Living the Dream. And I tried to make it as, you know, tangible and helpful as possible throughout the book. When that project ended, I knew that eventually I would come up with a bit more of a self-help tool. Because as people read books like Living the Dream, and for example, some of the other great, you know, photography business books, Best Business Practices for Photographers by John Harrington. If you can get past the redacted legal content in that book, it's got some real gems. David Duchman's Vision Mongers, Dane Sanders' Fast Track for Photographers. Mm-hmm. You know, there are books like that, you know, they're great shots information and insight and encouragement around your photography business, I knew that when I was done living the dream, I wanted to, the next natural step for me was to create a tool that people could use to actually plan their businesses themselves. I say that because, of course, I would happily charge them thousands of dollars and do their strategic planning for them. In fact, we did some business action planning as a service for a while. But, you know, the reality is that it is an ongoing process. It takes a lot of self-reflection. And we knew that we needed to make this something that people could do at their own pace and kind of work through it on their own. So that was a really long answer to a short question. But it came out of the need to sort of say, hey, I want to give photographers something that they can work on, you know, without being handheld all the way through. Hopefully this resource helps them, but, you know, it's a real process for them.
Indeed. Start to finish, how much time do you think it would take for somebody to go get through Business Action Planner? Is it something that you feel should just take its own organic course of time, or is it something that you should set limits to and say, well, by Monday we should have certain things done? And is that, how do you personally work on these things?
That's a dangerous question because there's a lot of variables, you know. And
sure.
I think one of the things that's really great about the Business Action Planner is that I've literally provided as many questions. I call them Kickstarter questions. I've provided as many questions as you could possibly fathom when it comes to evaluating and understanding not only you know, where you were, where you are, and where you need to go, but sort of when, like, looking at target market planning and you're building your target audience. I mean, I think I identified like 13 or 14 questions that before you can start planning those things, you need to make sure you have a really good understanding of you know, who you want to serve, how you want to serve them, where your sellable skills are, mm-hmm. and all those kind of factors. So I think when it comes to the timeline, I think, first of all, it depends on where someone's business is at. If they're sort of, if they've been in it for a while and they're kind of steering a moving ship already, mm-hmm. You know, then they're going to look at the Business Action Planner and they're probably going to pluck out the three or four areas that are of the biggest concern for them. I mean, it's, they've identified their business issues because they're the ones that make them cry at night, the ones that make their bank account, you know, dwindle. And so they're going to focus on those. For those that are a little bit at the more at the start of the process, I think they're going to treat it a little bit more linear and they're going to kind of walk through the whole thing. So to be honest, with, you know, a lot of work, you know, or it could be a few hours, it could be a few months, okay. Depending on what someone's doing. So we literally, I wanted to give the photographer more than they can handle. I actually kind of wanted to overwhelm someone. Oh, that happens when you, whenever you charge money for a product, you really want to feel like you've overwhelmed them with value. And I really wanted to do that with this planner. So that's why. It's a gigantic ebook. The guidebook is huge. And then we did some really clever stuff with Evernote and created some Evernote files that we actually turned the ebook into an Evernote file. We've never done that before. I've never done that before. Never even seen that before. So I thought that was fun to put the guidebook in Evernote format. But then the actual planning tool is an Evernote file that I've pre-populated with questions and placeholders and right. action steps and stuff. So
excellent, excellent. One of the things I when I approached by folks who have resources, you know, such as yours or you know others in the business, I'm always like left to wonder, how does one get feedback for the kind of work that goes into, like, even if it's do it yourself, like I may put words down, but I don't have a way of saying, well, are these all valid, you know, or yeah. are these all going the right direction, you know?
Yeah.
So do you have any suggestions for somebody such as myself, you know, who wants to get into the Business Action Planner and wants to dive in deep and get those answers for my business?
Yeah.
How do I know that I'm going the right direction?
Yeah. Well, there's a number of points along the way through the Action Planner where I try to help people build up a you know, within their sphere of influence, build up some trusted voices, people that they can go to and kind of say, hey, listen, if I have a question about marketing, can I come talk to you about my marketing? You know, a lot of photographers, when they're networking with fellow photographers, or they want to ask some industry, you know, peer or leader a question, they typically ask them like, oh, you landed Nike. How can I land Nike? Yeah, that's not a good question. Don't ask, you know. No. I always tell them, you know, if you're going to creep another photographer, stop looking at their photographs and, you know, ask them, you know, who their lawyer is, you know, or ask them, you know, how they got to this point, you know, from that point to this point, the process. Don't ask them about, right. you know, the particulars. So definitely finding those trusted voices within your own network is important. Dare I say, of course, if someone has a question, they can always email me. though if I think the answer is going to be long, I might send an estimate along with it. But the reality is that we all need feedback in our businesses. And right. photographers, especially those that have kind of started it in the quietness of their own mind or heart, they suddenly realize, yeah, they've written down an answer and they're like, well, that's my answer. It might not be a very good one. And what if I pursue this and I've gone down the wrong path? So I was thinking about starting an online support group where we all just cry together. you know, I think it is important. You know, a lot of people join photography clubs. And sometimes I'm not sure why they do. Sometimes it's like, are you just joining them because you want to join in yet another contest? Or you're just looking for people to pat you on the back? I'm like, if you've joined a club or an association of some, you know, that means you have a network of people that are doing it, approaching their photography like you, probably you are. My goodness, ask them, you know, bring your Evernote, you know, on your phone and go, hey, everyone, I have a question about, you know, about social media, or I have a question about, you know, contracts, you know, and ask them and ask people around you. There seems to be this, in some ways, photographers have a bit of industry-itis. Where it's sort of like this inbreeding that happens, but it's inbreeding from a craft perspective, but not from a business perspective. So I think photographers need to ask each other business questions. I'm not sure why they don't, but
I think it's probably because, and at least in the Western world where we live, it's probably considered rude to ask questions about how much one makes or what one's process is, or in terms of business is, you know, is concerned. Like how, because the minute you start asking questions about how you approached, you know, Nike, for instance, you know, or whatever, it becomes like, oh wait, he's trying to steal my business, you know, he's trying to steal my client, or to that.
And
effect.
that's why a network that's a little diversified, you know, a photographer, like, you know, wedding photographers, you know, they sort of, wedding photography is a niche that I actually find really interesting. Traditionally, a wedding photographer has a better business process than other photographers. Wedding photographers tend to have more, you know, legalese to support their efforts and protect themselves. Wedding photographers tend to have a bit of a sales process. In fact, wedding photographers, they're the ones that create packages and defined pricing, where a lot of other photographers are like, hey, I'll just do whatever. We'll just make it up as we go. And wedding photography has developed this reputation for a business acumen beyond some of the other niches. But asking business questions from those that are a little outside your niche, different, you know. For example, a landscape photographer who wants to get published in a magazine, okay, maybe talking to an editorial photographer might not be the best way to approach it. You might ask them some questions, but maybe approach another kind of photographer or someone else that serves the editorial market. They might not be a photographer, but they might be a photo buyer or an editor or a publisher or a writer. Mm-hmm. Writers, in fact, are very informed people, you know, because they're working with photographers and such.
Right,
so
absolutely.
It's finding those answers without being, you know, that moron that says, well, how much do you make?
Yeah.
How much did you charge Nike?
Yeah.
Boy, Nike's getting some bad rap here, right?
I know. Well, sorry about that, Nike.
Yeah, that's right.
Corwin, it's been a pleasure talking to you. You know, I recommend both the book and the new resource that you've just launched, Business Action Planner. I look forward to diving into it myself. In all confessions out there, I haven't really like looked into it, but you know, it's something that
it's too long. It's too long.
The fact is, you've overwhelmed me, you know. So,
perfect.
So I was just looking at it like, wow, this thing goes on and on and on. I've got an Evernote account, so it's an easy upload to Evernote and boom, I'm there. But thank you so much for what you do for the industry. I know a lot of people wonder why there are these, you know, these peripheral people out there who are, like only marketing to photographers. Well, there are people out there who are marketing photographers because there's a need for this stuff. You know, there's an absolute need for people to be guided through this process. It's not like you pick up a camera and you just become a photographer and you can start a business. You know,
right.
I think some thought needs to be put into it. And I'm so glad you've written both a book and also providing this resource that can actually help people, you know, make better lives of themselves, you know? So thank you.
Awesome. Good deal. Thank you.
Take care, buddy.
Appreciate it.
Take care.
You bet.
Bye.